गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
गुड आफ्टरनून सी अपूर्व सर इज गोइंग टू जॉइन और नॉट हैव यू आस्क हिम जस्ट कॉल हिम अपूर्व सर।
यस मैम।
सर वो लेक्चर था मैं पूछ रहा आपसे।
यस मैम।
नहीं 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 चाहिए ग्लव्स नहीं।
गुड इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग।
सॉरी सर।
सॉरी नीना मैम तुम्हें जॉइन करो सर मैं तो चालू कर दिया ना।
यस
सर। की कीजु सर। ओके स्टार्ट।
यस सर। सो आई विल बी प्रेजेंटिंग दिस सेमिनार ऑन बेनाइन ब्रेस्ट डिजीजेस। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई
You mute your or exit from your mobile.
I'm not logged in on my mobile now.
But it is echo sound, so you might be having simultaneously mobile on nearby.
No, ma'am.
Somebody else, anybody else sitting with you with a mobile on?
Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. So I'll first be beginning with the introduction to the breast, the anatomy part of it. So breast, first of all, consists of the following parts, which are namely the mammary gland, the superficial fascia covering it, and the overlying skin with the nipple areola complex. Now, breast in itself is an apocrine sweat gland, though it does not have a capsule, as is common with other sweat glands. It grows along the milk line, extending from the inguinal region up to the limb bud of the primordial axilla in a curvilinear fashion. Normally, single pair of glands develop in the pectoral region, one gland on each side. Though there can be congenital deformities where there can be multiple nipples, such as in polyamasia. Then, the greatest development of the breast tissue occurs by the age of 20 years. And simultaneously, as the reproductive age ends around 40 to 45 years of age, that is the premenopausal age, the atrophy begins as well. Now, anatomy wise, the breast extends superiorly from the second or the third rib space up to the sixth or seventh.
Repeat, because you were not audible.
In the first slide.
Atrophy begins. What do you want to say?
Yes, ma'am. The atrophy begins at the premenopausal age, as the reproductive age of the female also comes to an end around 40 to 45 years of age. At that age, the atrophy.
So it is a hormonal influence.
Yes,
by the atrophy.
It can be hormonal influence because the estrogen is the major contributor for the functioning of the breast tissue. And
estrogen is also available from the adrenal gland.
Yes, ma'am, but that is not in the sufficient amount for the functioning of the breast tissue. The main source of estrogen in a female are the ovaries.
See, in a male, when there is a liver failure, there is a gynecomastia.
Ma'am, that is because of the conversion of peripheral formation of estrogen by the adipose tissues. Not because of the excessive secretion by the adrenal glands or that sort. Similarly, in obese
people. What is the cause of gynecomastia in liver failure?
Liver failure.
So destruction of the estrogen also occurs into the liver. So because of that, the destruction is failed. So high level of estrogen remains in male also because of the liver failure, and that will end up with the gynecomastia.
Right? Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next.
So in anatomy, the breast tissue extends superiorly from the second or the third rib space up till the sixth or the seventh rib space inferiorly. While medially, it extends from the lateral border of sternum, where the pectoralis major is attached as well, up to laterally, up to the anterior or the mid-axillary line. Now,
so this anatomy is very much important, no? Whenever you are doing MRM,
yes,
particularly. See, when you are making two flaps in the MRM, you should not go beyond the mid-axillary line while dissecting it.
Yes,
see, you have to spare the vessels going to the latissimus dorsi. You are not going to remove the fat which is beyond it. So only the you have to remove the subcutaneous fat. You are not going to remove. You may injure this vessel going to the latissimus dorsi.
Okay.
So for that you have to extend your dissection up to the mid axillary line. This is important. Okay.
Yes. So. Breast tissue is specifically located within the superficial fascial compartment of the anterior chest wall. That is, the superficial fascia has a superficial compartment covering the breast tissue and a deeper fascia which forms the base of the breast tissue. Now, in a normal female, the breast consists of 15 to 20 tubular alveolar glandular tissues, fibrous connective stroma, as well as adipose tissue. Now, these 15 to 20 lobes are composed of various lobules which pour their secretions into lactiferous ducts. Now, these lactiferous ducts, they all converge into the nipple and under the areola, where the secretion of milk as in lactation occurs.
What is it known as? You have written. Okay, next slide. Next sentence. Okay.
Each lactiferous duct enlarges to form the lactiferous sinus, which narrows again to open at the summit of the nipple.
Okay.
This is the figure depicting the anatomy of the breast tissue. Now, the breast tissue, they are held by certain septate ligaments extending from the skin up till the base of the breast, which are known as Cooper's ligaments. There are various lobules which drain into the lactiferous ducts, which eventually drain into lactiferous sinus just before ending in the nipples. Now, as I said, the breast is found in the superficial fascial compartment of the skin. The deep layer of the superficial fascia lies upon the posterior surface of breast tissue and fuses with the deep investing fascia of pectoralis major, thus the pectoralis fascia. Now this space, the between these two layers, forms the retromammary space. Also, the breast parenchyma extending into the anterior axillary fold lies deep to deep fascia in axillary tail of Spence, which might be prominent in some females physiologically. The lobes are separated by septa of fibrous tissue attached from the deep layer of the superficial fascia, that is the base of the breast, to the dermis of the skin perpendicularly, called as the suspensory ligaments of Cooper, which helps to suspend the breast tissue. The posterior surface of the breast lies on the pectoralis major muscle, the serratus anterior muscle, and the external oblique abdominal muscles, and also the upper extent of the rectus sheath, thus having a large muscle base. The nipple areola complex. The nipple areola complex.
What is the surgical significance of this ligament of Cooper?
In conditions such as pure day orange, where there is subcutaneous edema, the skin, the ligament of Cooper does not extend, thus leading to the typical.
No. That is because of lymphedema. That OD orange is because of lymphedema, blockage of the lymphatics. Right. This suspensory ligament of Cooper is involved in malignancy, will give rise to lymphedema or puckering. Because its neurovascular bundle also passes through it. So it produces malignancies through this Cooper's ligament. That is one thing. Second thing is, in a postmenopausal woman, when they are lactating, there is a, sometimes because of the enlargement of the breast, this stretching of this suspensory ligament occurs. So nowadays people are giving physiotherapy to the post-lactating woman or during the pregnancy also for to support the breast. That acts as a supporting to the breast. Okay. So for that, it extends from skin to the pectoralis fascia. So that should be tight for that. Yes, so exercise helps for tightening of the breast. So that is the surgical significance. So if this nipple level is below the retromammary line, it is a those patients are indicated for treating the patient. This is a, not a malignant condition. This is a benign condition. So nipple is lying below the retromammary line. That is an initial stage. If it is lying two intercostal space below that, then those patients can go for mammoplasty, right? So they tighten this suspensory ligament as well as they tighten the breast by that, right? Okay.
Yes.
Next.
So the nipple areola complex, it consists of sebaceous glands, sweat glands, and accessory glands, which produce small minor elevations on its surface, which in cases of postpartum women, form small tubercles known as Montgomery's tubercles, which are basically enlarged sebaceous glands for moisturizing the nipple as the baby suckles on the nipples.
So these Montgomery tubercles may get enlarged sometimes.
Yes,
so that also produces. Have you taken this as a anywhere else? Montgomery tubercles as a space value? Anywhere else? Have you taken anywhere else Montgomery tubercles as a
pathology, ma'am is asking.
As a pathology.
That is also benign disease.
Have you taken it or not?
No, ma'am.
No. So normally it do not require treatment. But when it enlarges too much or it is having sometimes the hair which is coming out from the Montgomery tubercle also sometimes. So it gets infected, patient may develop abscess. You have to differentiate this Montgomery tubercle from the duct ectasia sometimes. So it is one type of differential diagnosis for that. Okay, next.
The arterial supply for the breast tissue, it is mainly arises from the three major arterial routes. Firstly, in the midline, the internal thoracic artery, which gives perforating branches to the mammary tissue. Then superolaterally, there are the thoracoacromial trunk and the lateral thoracic artery, which gives pectoral branches to the mammary tissue. And lastly, the intercostal arteries, which give the lateral cutaneous branches to supply the breast. These three form the major arterial supply for the breast tissue. Now, parallel to these, the venous system also follows these pathways. Now, the specific thing here would be the posterior intercostal veins. They lie in direct continuity with the vertebral plexus of veins known as the Batson's plexus, which surrounds the vertebra and extends from the base of the skull to the sacrum.
And so it is not, so it is not having valves, so malignancy
from
spread. The brace spreads there.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. To the vertebra.
The lymphatic drainage. The lymphatic drainage is basically divided into two lymphatic plexuses, the subareolar plexus of the sappi for superficial parts of the breast, and the pectoral plexus on the pectoral fascia for deeper parts.
So they utilize this, go back. Nowadays, people are utilizing this subareolar plexus of sappi for sentinel node biopsy. See, previously people were using only the indigo carmine is injected surrounding the malignant cells, surrounding malignant tumor. Or after the wide excision, they were injecting there, and then they with gamma camera, they were following it to the axilla and they were removing sentinel node. Nowadays, it is changing, and now people inject in subareolar plexus. Wherever it is a tumor, to find out the sentinel node, the dye is injected, particularly indigo carmine green. That is injected in subareolar plexus of the sappi, and so that will drain. See, after lifting the nipple areola complex, it is injected there, and then with the massaging, with the gamma for 2 minutes, and a gamma camera will follow this drainage into the lymphatics. And wherever it stops, that area is considered as a site of lymph node. This lymphatic lymph drainage stops. So they mark it and then explore that area, and then green colored lymph node is removed. For this. So this lymphatic is used nowadays.
Okay.
Next.
But the main lymphatic pathway for the breast tissue is formed by the axillary lymph nodes, which are divided into three levels. Level one, which forms, which is again divided into three groups. That is the anterior group or the pectoral group. Along the lower border of the pectoralis minor, it drains the whole chest wall along with the upper abdomen up till the umbilicus. The posterior group, the subscapular group, it is closely related to the subscapular vein, and it drains the back of the back up till the iliac crest. Now, the third group, the lateral humeral group, along the side of the axillary vein, it drains the upper limb. And all of these three, they further drain into the central groups, which lie behind the pectoralis minor at the floor of the axilla. These three drain into the central groups. Then another level two is the interpectoral or the Rotter's lymph nodes, which is between the pectoralis major and the minor muscle. The Rotter's lymph nodes and the central group, these further drain into the apical group, also known as the infraclavicular group behind the clavicle. It drains the central group, and these further go into the supraclavicular lymph nodes, which become the end point for the infraclavicular lymphatic drainage. Then we come to the benign breast diseases, which would be the main topic for this seminar. Now, what is a benign breast disease? It is when a radiological or a palpable abnormal area in the breast is subjected to biopsy and the pathology, the histopathological examination comes back to be benign. Now, these may have an elevated risk for cancer, and these may not even have any risk of cancer, which we will discuss based on the different pathologies. These diseases, they consist essentially of four features that may vary in extent and degree in any one breast. There can be cyst formation, which are almost inevitable and very variable in size. There can be fibrosis, as the fat and the elastic tissues disappear and are replaced with dense white fibrous trabeculae, and the interstitial tissue was also infiltrated with chronic inflammatory cells. There can be hyperplasia of the epithelium in the lining of the lactiferous ducts and the acini, with or without atypia. And in severe cases, there can be epithelial hyperplasia, which may be so extensive that it results in papillomatous growths, as can be seen in ductal papillomas. These four are the main pathologies which form the base of the various diseases in various combinations, which we would discuss further. Then,
listen. Have Lovelly not used the word ANDI? They stop using the word ANDI.
They nowadays we use the aberrations of normal development and involution. This classification of the benign breast diseases.
What is the concept? What is the concept? What is the idea behind calling it an ANDI?
Yes, sir. ANDI basically divides the.
What is the idea? Why do they call it?
They divide.
So basically, what they
yes, sir.
What they consider it is it's a production, growth, and involution. The whole breast process, the process of development and then diminution of the breast tissue, the whole process, wherever there is some aberration in the normality, you get some particular thing that is known as the what you known as the benign breast disease.
Yes.
So if you consider the tissues in the breast, that is the lobules, the ductules, the fatty tissue. So depending upon, and that already you said the four things, fibrosis, papillosis,
cyst
formation. So depending upon which area gets affected and how it get affected, it gets a new name of the disease.
Yes, sir.
So I think ANDI is a good word to be used.
Yes, sir. ANDI basically divides all of the benign diseases into three categories.
Yeah.
The early reproductive years, the late reproductive years, and the involution age. And these have basically the early reproductive years would have the development of the lobules, which if has aberrations, as we might say, will lead to fibroadenoma, which if larger than 3 centimeters would be called a giant fibroadenoma. There would be a normal development of stroma, which whose aberration would be adolescent hypertrophy. Then similarly, nipple eversion occurs in the early reproductive years, which if hampered will lead to nipple inversion. So it basically distorts the normal physiological development of the breast in the early reproductive years. Then similarly, in the late reproductive years, there can be there are cyclical changes of menstruation, which if has any abnormality can cause cyclical mastalgia or nodularity, or cyclical mastalgia with nodularity, also known as fibrocystadenosis. Then there is epithelial hyperplasia of pregnancy in the later reproductive years, which can cause bloody nipple discharge if abnormal. In the involution age group, that is 35 to 55 years, perimenopausal age group, there is lobular involution. The lobules, they decrease in size, which if yet again has any aberrations, can lead to sclerosing lesions or macrocysts. And there is also involution of the ducts. If there is duct dilatation, it would lead to duct ectasia. If there is ductal sclerosis, if hampered, it will lead to nipple retraction. Then again, the last would be the epithelial turnover. Epithelial turnover decreases as the age increases, but it can be abnormal and can lead to epithelial hyperplasia, which is a disease and can be pre-malignant if it is a epithelial hyperplasia with ATPR, which is revealed on histopathological examination. Another classification that we use for benign breast diseases is on the basis of degree of epithelial proliferation. there can be non-proliferative disorders of the breast, which does not involve any proliferation of the epithelial tissue. That is the cysts and apocrine metaplasia. There is duct ectasia, namely ductal dilatation. Mild ductal epithelial hyperplasia is also a non-proliferative disorder. Minor calcifications and fibroadenoma. All of these form together the non-proliferative disorders of the breast. The proliferative disorders are those without atypia or with atypia. Without atypia carry the less chances of being pre-malignant, which can be sclerosing adenosis, which is basically aberration in the normal ductal sclerosis in the involutional age group. There can be radial and complex sclerosing lesions, ductal epithelial hyperplasia, or intraductal papillomas. Then the third group is the atypical proliferation lesion, proliferative lesions, which includes atypical lobular and atypical ductal hyperplasia, which are basically pre-malignant lesions and can lead to carcinoma of the breast. Now, individually benign breast disorders, the first one would be breast cysts. Now, these are cysts which are fluid-filled, epithelial-lined cavities, which can be varying in size from microscopic to large palpable masses. And these basically arise from destruction and dilatation of lobules and terminal ductules. The main culprit behind them can be ovarian hormones, for example, estrogen. And these most commonly occur after the age of 35 years. And the incidence increases up to menopause and sharply decreases thereafter, since the influence of ovarian hormones decreases after menopause. There is no evidence of increased risk for breast cancer, and it is a totally benign condition. These can be diagnosed well on an ultrasound, and aspiration can be diagnostic as well as therapeutic for these. But the main problem here can be it can recur multiple times. So we can do pneumocystography or core needle biopsy to confirm the diagnosis. And the treatment modalities can be aspiration, which is diagnostic as well as therapeutic. Then we can also do surgical excision. But these recur multiple times, then we have to go for biopsy, which might show atypia, which would be a red light as it can be a pre-malignant lesion. This covers the breast cysts. The next one is the most common benign breast disease, we can say, in the women of early reproductive age group, the fibroadenoma. It is composed.
Hello.
Ma'am, I can't hear you.
Okay.
Yeah, I can.
Good evening, I'm there.
Good evening, sir.
Sorry to be late. I forgot actually and was busy. Okay.
Good evening, sir.
Continue.
Yes, sir. Fibroadenoma, which is the most common benign tumor in the women of reproductive age group, that is 15 to 25 years of age. It is composed of stromal as well as epithelial components, and it is a pretty common disorder in the late teens and early reproductive years. The fibroadenomas are typically painless, palpable, mobile, well-defined masses with smooth surface, and they are so mobile that they are also called as breast mouse. These are well-encapsulated masses. Then they can be divided into various types depending on their sizes. They can be small fibroadenomas, less than equal to 1 centimeter, which do not need any intervention. Then there are larger ones, less than 3 centimeters, which can be a disorder that is being a variation of the normal physiology. Then the giant fibroadenomas, which are more than 3 centimeters in size, which are classically termed as diseases, which require surgical intervention. Also, the fourth type would be the multiple fibroadenomas, which are more than 5 lesions in any one breast, which is also considered a disease and requires surgical intervention. Then there is a term known as juvenile fibroadenoma, which is a large fibroadenoma in adolescents and young adults, which is histologically more cellular than the usual fibroadenoma and is comparatively larger in size. There is also a term known as complex fibroadenoma, which typically occurs in older age groups as opposed to juvenile fibroadenoma, which have a typical fibroadenoma and fibrocystic changes, but they occasionally may turn into malignancies, thus complex fibroadenomas.
When will you say it is a large fibroadenoma?
Or giant, what is a giant?
Giant fibroadenoma.
He has said that, but I don't agree.
Sir, actually some textbooks mention giant fibroadenomas to be more than 5 centimeters.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, sir. But more than 3 centimeters fibroadenomas require surgical intervention.
What is the differential diagnosis of giant fibroadenoma?
A giant fibroadenoma would have to be differentiated from phyllodes tumor.
Other than this? See, at the time of puberty, sometimes few female will have increase in size of the one side of breast. So that large breast of one side may be looking like this patient is having giant fibroadenoma, and those to be differentiated, it requires mammoplasty in that case.
Fibroadenomas are typically benign tumors, although neoplasm may develop in the epithelial elements, but it is a quite rare entity. Most of them are self-limiting and go undiagnosed. But on palpable fibroadenomas, various investigations are done, such as ultrasound with core needle biopsy to provide the accurate diagnosis of fibroadenoma. Mammosonography can be done, which reveals typical popcorn calcifications.
So all the fibroadenoma will have popcorn calcification?
No, ma'am. Only larger fibroadenomas.
So it should not be as a first. This is last. What is the normal fibroadenoma looking?
Sorry, ma'am.
What about the normal fibroadenoma showing in mammosonography? Normal mammosonography.
What madam is asking, Anik, means if you do a mammosonography of a fibroadenoma other than giant, what will be it look on mammography?
This is something different. Popcorn calcification is not seen in all the fibroadenomas.
Oh. Otherwise, they would not be visible on mammography.
No. It will be. Okay.
Mammography of so many patients, and we find out this is a benign swelling. What is
this? There would be smooth masses, smooth round masses, and well encapsulated. Without any tensions or hypodensities.
So if there is a calcification other than popcorn, which type of calcification it will be?
So there can be micro calcification.
No, that is a malignancy. So here it will be a smooth, well-defined, occasional, you can call it like a mirror image type of calcification, which will be not a micro, it will be macro. But most of the time, it will be only soft tissue shadow. But it soft tissue shadow is always seen in fibroadenoma. Popcorn calcification is common in a very giant fibroadenoma, and that needs further investigation. Small fibroadenoma, they do not need any investigation in form of. Second problem here is when you have written mammosonography, it is sonography, not the mammography, which is commonly done. Why?
Because in younger age
group. Yes. So most of the fibroadenoma patients are younger age group. Rarely they occur after 40 years of age. So those patients are usually not undergoing mammography. So usually it is a USG finding. So what are the USG finding in fibroadenoma?
Sir, on USG, the fibroadenoma would be a well-rounded, smooth mass.
Now, when you describe fibroadenoma USG, you usually think in term of hypo, hyper, iso.
It would be hypodense.
Hypo or hyper?
Hypo.
Hypo will be present in cyst. Hypo is always present in cyst. All the cysts are hypoechoic.
Right? It's a hyperdense, giving a typical, sometimes post, also like a gallstone post swelling halo. You understand? So that is the very, because usually in fibroadenoma, the cells are very closely packed together. So it gives hyperdense and they are usually giving post halo like that. So that should be kept. Mammography is usually not done in most of the fibroadenoma. It is a clinical diagnosis. Will you do FNAC in all cases?
No, sir. Not in all.
So what are the indication of FNAC in fibroadenoma?
Sir, we do FNAC in large fibroadenomas, firstly.
No. Before that. Patient who is having positive history and who are perimenopausal.
These exactly.
Are indication for
FNAC. After 40, FNAC should be done in all fibroadenoma. If clinical diagnosis is fibroadenoma, if it is a less than 3 centimeter size, you can do excision biopsy in a younger patient, but beyond 40, more than 3 centimeter size fibroadenoma should be investigated by FNAC at least. Or if there is a higher suspicious, straightway what you have said is a core needle biopsy, right? So it is again a clinical judgment which should be kept in mind. What is any other classification of fibroadenoma which you know?
So there can be pathological classification.
That is?
The intracanalicular and the pericanalicular classification.
Okay. You have written it?
No, sir. I have not mentioned.
So what is
pericanalicular? What is the difference in intracanalicular and pericanalicular?
In pericanalicular, there is hypercellularity surrounding the canaliculi and the canaliculi are patent. Whereas in intracanalicular, there is collapse of the canaliculi.
Which canaliculi?
Lactiferous canaliculi.
Right. So, rather, yes.
Yes, continue.
Neighbors, you can.
So intracanalicular, if it is diagnosed, if you excise one fibroadenoma intracanalicular, if it is diagnosed histopathologically, usually those patients may develop a multiple fibroadenomas. So it is found routinely that those who are having intracanalicular type of fibroadenoma, those patients may have multiple, so in both the breast.
Yes. So that is also one other diagnosis is a hard fibroadenoma and soft fibroadenoma. Usually intracanalicular are multiple soft spreader over the multiple site, whereas the pericanalicular you are usually single and they become very large. So sometimes giant fibroadenoma is associated with pericanaliculi. Am I right? I am not confused or
no? Yes.
And intra are multiple small. So that should be kept in mind, right? Giant
fibroadenoma is usually during the adolescent age group.
Maybe. Adolescent, yes. And the giant fibroadenoma pericanalicular should be differentiated from phylloid tumor. So sometimes phylloid was previously considered synonym with the giant fibroadenoma, but it is wrong. Phylloid itself is a different entity. But sometimes people consider it a part of fibroadenoma. So what is difference between phylloid tumor and fibroadenoma? Apart from clinic, pathologically, what is difference?
Sir, in phylloid tumor, the hypercellularities which we see on microscopic examination, they typically look like the leaves of the tree.
By which part is disease in phylloid?
I don't know.
So it is, if the malignancy occur, it is a sarcoma. So understand, it's a stromal tissue of a breast. When it becomes enlarged with cell, it is a phylloid tumor. It can be benign, it can be malignant. Many times, giant fibroadenoma exactly present like a phylloid tumor. But if, what care you will take if the histopatho report is phylloid?
If the histopathological report is a phylloid tumor, then we would like to go for mastectomy instead of wide local excision.
No.
It's a benign tumor. Why do you want to go for mastectomy?
The phylloid's tumor has a risk of being turned.
But you have removed it.
See, you get mammosonography, you know, and you can have MRI also. So you can know the extent of tumor in the breast tissue. So you can excise those breast tissue by submammary large incision also. It's not a question.
So you have to, histopathology is a very important when we are talking of phylloid tumor. If it is a benign, close observation, regular follow-up, and explain to the patient the recurrence rate is very high. The recurrence can be malignant, can be benign again. But if it recurs, you have to investigate for malignancy, right? And if it is a benign, repeated excision may be required. In those cases, rather than if it is a benign and very large and recurrent, what can be done?
If it is very large and recurrent, we can go for radiotherapy.
Are no, benign. We are talking benign.
Benign swelling. It's not ready. It's not required a therapy.
What you were initially saying, what is known as a subcutaneous mastectomy? What is that? So here it is a benign tumor. You preserve the skin, nipple, areola, and remove whole breast tissue, which is causative. If it is a malignant, then the treatment is a totally different. We are talking of benign. Madam, anything you want to add?
No, only thing is whenever you are doing this, you have diagnosis, then extra capsular and little bit with the breast tissue, you have to excise this phylloid tumor. In a fibroadenoma, we are doing intracapsular, we can do extra capsular as well as intracapsular excision. Right, so that is a difference in treatment because the true capsule in fibroadenoma. So intracapsular, it is a condensation of the breast tissue surrounding the fibroadenoma. So when you are excising, particularly when patient is having intraductal, so that duct has been enlarged and it becomes just like a capsule. So, or it is a condensation of the breast tissue surrounding the fibroadenoma. So you put the incision over it and then just like enucleation, you can remove this fibroid, but not phylloid tumor. If your FNAC show phylloid tumor, it is always with the some breast tissue surrounding.
So it is not extensive, but extracapsular with in the remaining in the normal breast tissue that decreases the chances of recurrence. Okay.
What is this anthel? I do not know about this.
Antler horn, I don't know. What is that?
What is it? I do not know.
The antler horn would be the branching of branching pattern of the canalicule as seen on the microscopic examination.
Okay.
On microscopy?
On microscopy, yes.
Okay.
I have not heard it. I don't know.
I am also hearing for the first time.
I have not heard. So how can you see that canalicule in FNAC? That I would like to know.
So
is it a FNAC or FNAB?
It would be FNAB.
In cell, how can you see that antral horn pattern? Or is it a intracellular? That's all right. Like in case when you do it for a thyroid, there is a certain type of cells you are seeing. What is that name of that cell? Kayo aibu che? That is known as a. So that is all right, but here how can you say I don't know? It should be 5-FNAB. I am not sure. So please read it again. Okay. Yes,
the treatment modalities for the fibroadenomas would we can go for surgical excision if the fibroadenoma is symptomatic, that is painful. If it is enlarging in size and if it is more than 2 centimeters, the various newer modalities can be cryoablation can be used. Then vacuum assisted biopsy can be used. Or removing the fibroadenomas less than 3 centimeters typically. And we can also observe the fibroadenomas if they are less than 3 centimeters.
So okay, agreed. Observation, surgical excision or observation. Other two are very rarely done. Why they are not done? Cryoablation or vacuum assisted biopsy. It is also somewhere related to stereotactic, which was one in the walk in between. What is that? Stereotactic surgery. For a breast, there is a big machine of 70 lakh. It is available in civil hospital, which was never used.
Yeah.
Anika was very fond of.
Yeah.
So what is that? So they used to say it is a mainly for a cosmetic purpose. Usually is in a young patient. So putting an incision is not proper. So these are the other option that there is a special needle available with a USG. You guide the needle inside the
tumor
and then with the help of vacuum and repeated thrust, it becomes a very liquid form and you just vacuum with the help of vacuum, suck it out. So that is the treatment, but it is a very cumbersome, very long process. So it is not very popular. It is useful particularly when patient doesn't want any incision. But the disadvantage is it will destroy the histopathology. So you need to do core needle biopsy or at least FNAC before going for a cryoablation or vacuum assisted biopsy. So still surgical excision or observation, these two are the main surgical options available. You should keep that in mind because the surgical excision is usually done for a reason that patient is very anxious and want to get rid of it. Even though you are very sure it is fibroadenoma, if patient insists, you should do it. Taking care here, the incision should be most cosmetic possible.
Now, in cases when the fibroadenoma is diagnosed presumptively, we can go for clinical follow-up every 6 to 12 months. And the fibroadenoma would need to be excised only if there is a rapid growth in its size. And no treatment is necessary if the diagnosis is confirmed and if the patient is comfortable with the lump.
Okay.
The next disorder would be the phyllodes tumor, which is a differential for giant fibroadenoma.
So this is a problem. This is very confusing. Some people consider cystosarcoma phylloid and serocystic disease of Brody is the same thing. It's wrong. From where did you take it?
I took it from Schwartz.
But must be very old. Actually, there is a confusion that what you should do. What is serocystic disease of Brody? Chalo, continue. We'll discuss it as time goes. Yes.
The phyllodes tumor, it occurs commonly in women of the older age group after 40 years of age. Now, phyllodes tumor can be benign, which is the most common condition, 85% of the cases. It can be borderline or it can be malignant, most commonly leading to sarcoma. Now, phyllodes tumor are a differential for large giant fibroadenomas, thus they are large, sometimes even massive. They are rapidly growing with an unevenly bosselated surface, whereas the giant fibroadenoma would have a smooth surface.
Very good.
They can lead to ulceration of the overlying skin due to the pressure exerted by the mass on the skin. Thus, due to the pressure, the skin is stretched. It is red. The veins.
Wait. Yes, if your patient is having this ulceration because of the benign mass, how will you differentiate it? What is the test for that to differentiate it from the ulcerated malignant mass?
We would go for wedge biopsy.
No. Clinical.
It is known as a matchstick test, in which you are passing the matchstick or any things beneath the skin. You are able to pass it beneath the skin. When there is because of the ulceration by the pressure ulceration by the benign tumor. If it is because of the malignancy, you are not able to do any dissection is found beneath the skin.
So the point here madam wants to say is that patient, if fungated, there is no space between skin and tumor. If it is ulceration due to pressure necrosis, the skin will be separate from tumor. And matchstick or a similar flat instrument, if you can pass between skin and tumor, it is ulceration and likely to be still benign. But if you cannot pass, then it is a mostly fungated. Second is ulcerated skin will be flat, whereas the fungated will be everted. That should be because it becomes very important to differentiate phyllod tumor from skin metastatized malignancy. Do you understand? Because the phyllod tumor, even though benign, can cause ulceration, but the malignant will not cause ulceration, more likely it cause fungation. So this simple test can differentiate whether it is actually ulceration or fungation.
Okay.
Then Phyllod's tumor is typically warmer due to high vascularity. It is not fixed to the skin as the mastic can be passed deep to the skin or deeper muscles or the chest wall. Now, nipple retraction here would be absent, which is typically due to the involvement of the suspensory ligament of Cooper. The lymph nodes are usually not involved, and these differentiate it from the carcinoma, in which in carcinoma, nipple retraction would typically occur. Lymph nodes are involved in advanced cancers. And despite the large size, these remain mobile on the chest wall as they are not fixed to skin or to the deeper muscles. Now, the treatment modalities for Phyllod's tumor would be wide excision with 1 centimeter margin, making sure that the normal breast tissue is involved and we excise it extracapsularly. Or,
so what are the other causes for doing the simple mastectomy? One is Phyllod's tumor. Which are the other causes for doing simple mastectomy? You are not doing axillary clearance in it. The one is recurrence in Phyllod tumor. Second, if a patient is having Paget's disease, then you can do simple mastectomy. Third is the patient who is insane. And parents want mastectomy, so it will be a subcutaneous mastectomy. So only the breast tissue is removed, nipple areola complex is preserved. Right? So these are the three main conditions. Previously we were doing in carcinoma in situ, nowadays we are not doing this. We are doing now in carcinoma in situ. If patient's compliance is not good, then you can do. But otherwise you have to do the breast conservative surgery in that case, disease.
And then if the Phyllod's tumor is of the malignant variety, typically the sarcomas, then we have to go for total mastectomy with adjuvant chemotherapy. But these carry a poor prognosis as the sarcomas would first spread to the lung and bones in the form of metastasis. The next benign breast disorder is fibrocyst adenosis, also known as cyclical mastalgia with nodularity, which is typically a disease of the late reproductive age group. Now, this is an estrogen-dependent condition which presents during the menstruating age group, that is the late reproductive, as we say, 25 to 35 years of age. It is common in the upper and outer quadrant. Now, it is the exaggerated response of breast stroma and epithelial to hormone and growth factors. Typically, sensitization of the cells to these factors. One of the cysts may get enlarged to become clinically palpable and a well-localized swelling, which gives it the name of the blue dome cyst of blood good.
See, now remember here, so the word fibrocyst adenosis. So there is a more fibrosis, more cyst formation, and more adenoid cyst formation. Simple cyst formation because of the dilatation of the duct. And globules, when it is enlarged, then it is adenosis, right? So all the three components of the breast are enlarged. It is hyperplasia and hypertrophy because of the increased or different response of this some part of the breast tissue in the response to the estrogen during the time of which time patient is having pain? Which time of menstruation patient is having pain?
Typically before menstruation.
So it is a pre-menstruation. And it may be because of the fluid loading also in response to this high level of disorder. Okay. How do you diagnose this blue dome cyst of blood
group? Blue dome cyst of blood group would be typically a large cyst which would be fluctuant and transilluminant in these cases. Typically in the upper and outer quadrants occur, which...
Why this area is more common? It is having more breast tissue. As compared to the whole breast, this axillary tail is upper outer quadrant includes axillary tail also. So it is having comparatively more breast tissue. So it is more commonly found. And pain, if there is a swelling, is there because of the pectoralis muscle. Contraction is more in that area. So because of the friction, patient is having more pain in that area. So in rest of the area, there will be a comparatively less. Okay.
And if there are multiple small diffuse cysts which form the main component of this disease, then that is typically the Schimmelbusch disease, which is a variant of fibrocystic adenosis. Then there are various stages of fibrocystic adenosis. The first would be stromal proliferation, that is fibrosis, then this adenosis, and lastly cyst formation, earning the name fibrocystic adenosis. Now, these can be classified on the basis of the proliferation of the cells. Non-proliferative would have moderate hyperplasia of the ductal luminal system. Then there can be proliferative, which would have more hyperplasia, but without ATPR. It is proliferative with ATPR variant, which is a risk factor for breast cancer with a relative risk of 4.5. Now, fibrocystic adenosis typically presents during the menstruating age group as bilateral, painful, diffuse, granular, tender swellings, which is better felt with the palpating fingers than the palm.
So when patient comes to you for palpation, when your patient will show you, you just ask, where is the swelling? He will show by lifting the breast with the forefinger. So with that of the hand, you cannot palpate this swelling. That is between this fibroadenoma and fibroadenosis. Which other things will be palpable, just like granular? What granular we use for other than this? It is in omentosil in our granular palpation. Okay, next.
Then the treatment modalities for fibrocystic adenosis firstly involves the conservative line, which is preferred, which includes firstly reassurance, and we have to ask the patient to avoid caffeine, chocolates, or salty products, as these exacerbate the pain. The second line would be the medical drugs, which typically involves oil of evening primrose, which is a relief in moderate pain. Then other various drugs used can be gamelanic acid, danazol, bromocriptine, tamoxifen, and LHRH agonist. Vitamin E is a factor which is used clinically in many scenarios. And NSAIDs are also said to relieve the pain in many cases.
How will you give primrose?
It is in the form of capsule.
Dose?
I'm not aware of.
That is usually given BD dose. And how will you start it? It is given as a continuous therapy. So whenever patient is having pain, you can give continuously for 1 month. It is not an interrupted therapy, right? But danazol is given as an interrupted therapy or continuous therapy. Danazol can be given from 100 to 400 milligrams. It is usually given in nighttime because it may give rise to nausea. It may also give rise to some edema because of its hormonal effect. So it is usually given at night. Tamoxifen 100 milligram is given from the fifth day of the menstrual cycle. So when the first day of the menstrual cycle, when patient starts menstruating, then first day of the menstrual cycle, the patient is explained to count from that. So fifth day to 15th day of this, so for 10 days, patient should take it. And then every month, patient will come in the follow-up before the menstrual cycle. And you have to again give it. Maximum you can give for 6 months. But if patient is having nipple discharge, usually we prefer to give as a continuous therapy. When patient takes continuous therapy, then there may not be a menstrual cycle. And if they forget to take one tablet, then they can take that tablet on the next day morning and then again in the evening. So otherwise there will be a menstruation or spotting. So patient should continue it, just like oral pills. Right?
Okay. So then
so the point is that basically what madam has said that by now we have two or three levels of medical management when it comes to fibroadenosis, starting with basic NSAID, the during primrose oil, which may or may not have any effect. We don't know how empirically it acted. Then came the danazol group, and then we have tamoxifen group. And latest, we have the hormonal exifin, that is Sevista, which we have been using with minimal side effects and twice a week dosage, which is very good. So basically, yes, you have to differentiate the medical management into empirical, but with the advent of, I think, hormonal exifin, I think use of tamoxifen is reduced. Danazol you can use.
And the danazol is actually a toxic drug. Keep that thing in mind. It should be used sparingly because of the its anti-estrogenic effect is there, because the basically these all act as an anti-estrogen and help to decrease the size and decrease the pain. Usually in such patient, the main important is the pain relief. That should be kept in mind. Swelling is very vague and it may or may not disappear. As Apurva has said, the most important is the newer Silasto. I think Nirmala had done that dissertation.
Yeah, Nirmala, and after that one another resident also has
Rusha.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So Rusha, so go through that. It is a very important and it gives good result. Only point is. Okay, continue.
Yes, sir. The next modality for the treatment of fibrocystic adenosis can be surgical management, which is done only in severe persistent diseases which are not responding to medical management, which can be done either by subcutaneous mastectomy with prosthesis placement or excision of the cyst or localized excision of the diseased tissue, which might provide relief for the refractory cases.
Not a good thing to be done for surgery is not a good option for this, basically because, of course, except for mastectomy probably, because most of the patients, the main complaint is pain, which does not go even after quadratectomy. So you may have to go for a mastectomy, and even after that, you may not be able to give a result. So be very careful if you are operating a patient of fibrocystic disease.
Okay. Yes, sir. The next benign breast disorder is sclerosing adenosis, which is a disease of the involutional age group. That is the 35 years to 55 years of age. Now, it may be a diffused or a focal adenosis having a presentation of recurring pain like cyclical mastalgia, but it often presents with a breast mass. Now, this condition mimics a carcinoma clinically, radiologically, and histologically, and it is also considered as an independent risk factor for developing breast cancer with 1.5 to 2 times higher the risk. But it is not considered as a precancerous condition. That is, it will not sure shot lead to cancer, but it increases the risk of developing cancer in the future. Excisional biopsy and histological examinations are done to exclude cancer. And the main modality here would be regular follow-up, which is necessary to continuously know if it is not having any malignant changes or not.
Okay.
The next disease is ductectasia, which is also a disease of the involutional age group. Ductectasia basically means there is dilatation of the lactiferous ducts as the myoepithelial cells, they relax with increasing age. And there is also periductal inflammation. And plasma cells form the major part of this inflammation. Thus, it is also known as plasma cell mastitis. It is typically more common in smokers with presentation of nipple discharge.
So, Anik, and for all the hearing, this is an important ductectasia is a very important benign breast disease. The reason is, what is the reason why it is very important disease?
Sir, duct ectasia can lead formation of abscess, a fistula.
No. The most important, it is the dilatation of the duct. Dilatation usually leads to stasis. Stasis followed by inflammation and puckering. So many patients of duct ectasia present as a retracted nipple. Understand this point. So it may mimic malignancy or Paget disease of nipple. Understand this point. The most important differentiating point of duct ectasia is the mass is confined behind the areola. If any patient having a mass which is beyond the areola, duct ectasia is most unlikely because it's a disease of major lactiferous ductule. 10-12 lactiferous ductule which are entering the nipple, because they become dilated and inflamed. And so it is usually associated with a thick desquamous discharge. It's a very typical of that. That way you can differentiate it from fibroadenosis, which will have a serous or similar discharge. Whereas the typical discharge of duct ectasia, you can compare it with the sebaceous cyst. Understand this point. Desquamous, because of the dilated duct and stasis, the whatever discharge is that is, it causes stasis and then gradually it comes out. Because of the prolonged condition, it also causes the shortening of the duct, pulling the nipple inside, and may present with puckering and retraction of nipple. Should be kept in mind, right? Second problem is that there is hardly any medical management for duct ectasia apart from symptomatic. The whatever treatment you give for fibroadenosis or any other similar fibrocystic disease does not work in duct ectasia. The most important differentiating, it's a disease of nipple areola complex and just behind it. No other part of breast is usually involved. The most important differentiating point will be fibroadenosis. It may mimic because it also has a discharge, but any swelling may be well-defined, ill-defined, extending beyond the areola or the duct ectasia. Okay.
The treatment for duct ectasia would
continue.
The treatment would firstly include that the patient stops smoking. Then a trial can be given for antibiotic therapy to decrease the inflammation and resolve any abscesses. The mainstay of treatment lies with surgery, with excision of all of the major ducts. That is also known as
the... Most of the time, it do not require excision of all of the duct. You have to find out the opening of the duct. See, when you press over the areola, then when you press over the areola, we will find out one opening on the nipple. So that through which the discharge is coming out, right? So before the surgery, you will not press for at least for 24 hours to see that how much is discharge or from where discharge is there. Once patient is admitted, you will not press over it. So collection, once it is diagnosed, you will allow that collection to remain there. That is one thing. During the surgery, you have to cannulate that duct for complete excision of the lactiferous sinus and the duct up to the nipple. Right? So you have to cannulate that duct. And for cannulation, we use either, if it is a larger, we use a thinner intracath, or we use the proline wire for cannulation of that duct. So once you pass this from this nipple, this proline wire, one number wire, and then we put incision over the nipple areola complex at the junction of the areola with the breast tissue, and lift that areola and find out that duct through which you can see that where it is going. And then you have to dissect out this duct and the sinus completely, right?
Okay.
That is known as a Hatfield's operation.
But other part of this is two things I would like to add. One is the role of mammography. Remember, when there is a doubt, mammography help. If it is a malignancy or with retraction, skin thickening will be seen and definite microcalcification with mass will be seen. If it is a duct ectasia, mammography, skin will be normal and there will not be microcalcification. And what Madam had said is known as a microdochectomy, which will be useful when the isolated duct is involved. But many patients of duct ectasia, more than one duct, multiple ducts are involved. Right? In those cases, what is done is, it is known as a It is a corn excision. What is that? Corn excision, it is known as. But it is possible to do only after menopause patient. It is not advisable to do patient who is having a pregnancy at time or rather that area. So below 35, it is not advisable conservative treatment because the corn excision will put a periareolar incision, elevate the flap, and all lactiferous ductule in form of starting from near nipple to that is removed in form of corn. So there will be connection will be lost and dilatation is removed, but that will cause permanent damage to lactation. So it is not to be done when the patient is likely to have a lactation. Do you understand? So head field operation is to be done only when that a lactation era of a particular patient is over. So beyond 40, this can be used full surgery. When the isodated duct is involved, like a microductomy we do for about duct papilloma. You squeeze it, find out the discommator from which duct it is coming, cannulate that with the help of proline suture, or what we usually use is a needle. You cannulate with needle or you can use lacrimal dilator. These are the things you can use. Okay.
The next benign disorder would be nipple inversion. This is a disorder of the development of the major duct, which prevents the protrusion of the nipple outside. And when it obstructs the major duct, it predisposes to the mammary duct fistula, which can further lead to stasis and inflammation, leading to infection, at last to recurrent subareolar abscesses.
So this can also occur if patient is newborn baby is given the phototherapy. At that time, they keep the folder gauze over the nipple areolar complex while giving the
The treatment modalities of nipple inversion, firstly would be aspiration of the abscess with proper antibiotic coverage. Then if it has led to formation of a subareolar fistula, we would have to do a fistulectomy with small abscesses in cases with small abscesses which are localized to one segment with mild or no nipple inversion, no discharge from the other ducts and in young patients. But in cases where there is a large abscess involving more than 50% of the areolar circumference with marked nipple inversion, purulent discharge from major other ducts, when the patient is older patient, not requiring lactation and recurrences after fistulectomy, then we need to go for total duct excision.
But if this is an inversion of the nipple during the pregnancy, what is the treatment for that? So at the lactating time, the breast pump is used. No? And then there is a massage is advised to the female so that they can pull the nipple little bit out by doing the massage. And so most of the time it is possible to give breastfeeding after 1 month of the lactation. So initially breast pump is utilized. Next.
The next two.
What happened? Continue. What happened? Lost it?
Yeah. It looks like
so. Hello, Anik. I think his connection is gone.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, he's coming. I would say, yes, Anik. Yes.
Yes, yes. Next slide.
The next would be cyclical mastalgia. Now, cyclical mastalgia and nodularity, which are typically associated with premenstrual enlargement of the breasts. These are considered normal, but if there is painful nodularity which persists for more than 1 week, then it is also considered as incapacitating mastalgia. The treatment for this would be to advise the patient to avoid any stressors and to give proper support to the breasts, which would help to decrease the pain.
And you have to give Lasix to the patient in premenstrual time for 5 days.
To decrease the fluid load. The next benign disorder would be radial scars, which belong to the complex sclerosing lesions. Now, these can mimic carcinomas radiologically as these form irregular spiculations in the surrounding stroma. Now, rarely these are more than 1 centimeters in length, and where when the larger lesions may form palpable tumors. These scars can cause skin dimpling, and the treatment modality would be the surgical excision and biopsy to rule out carcinoma. The next disease is ductal papilloma.
Anik, you should have taken this quite earlier. This is not radial scar. Duct papilloma I'm talking of. Why?
Simple. This is more common. Yes,
and important point is the presenting symptom usually is a bloody discharge from nipple. So this is the most stressful to the patient, duct papilloma, because it will mimic the malignancy and it should be treated. There is no conservative treatment for duct papilloma. Keep this thing in mind. That's why it is very important. It is commoner than the radial scar or this. Have you taken Mondor's disease or not?
Yes, sir.
It is still coming or you already said it?
It is coming afterwards.
Okay. So continue with duct papilloma. This is very important. So you should also understand when you are writing or speaking, the common thing first, yes, fibroadenoma, fibroadenosis, duct ectasia, duct papilloma. These are the common condition, yes, right? Radial scar or sclerosing adenosis, those are not a common condition. You should take it. What about galactosyl? Have you taken galactosyl or not?
Yes, sir. I have mentioned galactosyl.
You already mentioned?
No, it is coming.
There are a lot of things coming. I think we have to take a second lecture for that. Okay, duct papilloma.
Yes, sir. Duct papillomas are usually single and they arise from single lactiferous ducts. These are basically hyperplasia of the epithelial lining of the cells, which form true polyps within the lactiferous ducts. Usually, it is less than 1 centimeter in size with a small lump under the areola, but it can attain a larger size. These have a vascular stalk, which may project out of the through the nipple like a pedunculated mass. Now, single papilloma is not a pre-malignant condition, but multiple papillomas do. In multiple papillomas, we have to rule out the chances for malignancy. Now, duct papilloma, as sir mentioned, is the most common cause of bloody discharge from the nipple.
Nowadays, ductoscopy has also came there.
He has not written, that's what I hear. What is ductoscopy?
We would insert the videoscope through the duct and look for any hyperplasia.
It is there. If you go through the Google and you can find out the video of ductoscopy. But it has not become popular because to cannulate the duct, you need very thin thread. So wear and tear is so high, it is not worth doing it. Same thing goes for a ductogram. To do a ductogram is a very painful condition. So the best management in one, the most important is identify, because of where we have written FNAC, it is very rarely possible to do FNAC in a duct papilloma, unless it is more than 1 centimeter in size. And by that time, it is easy to diagnose. So keep that in mind. Most of the time, the FNAC and mammography are non-conclusive. So that's why people have invented ductogram and ductoscopy, but still it is not that popular. So whenever there is a bloody discharge not resolving within 15 days, the treatment is the only, and that is next.
The treatment includes microdocectomy.
Yes, that is the ideal. What we have already said, that is same thing you do is a microdocectomy. Identify the duct, cannulate the duct, and remove the, put a periareolar incision along with the duct. The most important is to remove the papilloma and send it for histopathology. That is the treatment in duct papilloma.
The next disease is gynecomastia. It is hypertrophy of the male.
I think, should we stop or continue, Apurva?
Yeah, we will stop.
I think I am also going.
Yeah,
but next time. Okay, continue. Because still, I because this is the one condition I would like to discuss for 15-20 minutes, gynecomastia itself.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a very important. Similarly, galactosyl, and what you have noted, the mastitis itself, you have not taken, take it. Mastitis and the types of mastitis, which is very important. It called also to the post-radiotherapy post-radiotherapy mastitis should also be included. Those are the common condition. So next time we'll take it. Thank you. The one or two point one. Purva, we are getting less and less presence. There are 19 and they are only of Monday, Wednesday and Friday. Nobody else is there. One or two people are there. So
today is our emergency, so we can change from Thursday to somewhere else.
Okay, we'll see that. It is a we'll have to think of something. One second point is that about the poster and paper. So local student convey to all BJ students that it should be given to Prujal before tomorrow, before Saturday morning. After Saturday morning, we will not consider any poster or paper for a Sunday's, right? Madam, it's okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
We have given the deadline of 25th. You have at least one day.
One day, that's 26th morning. So we should, and because we have to have a day to finalize the schedule and the generate the link and everything and decide the which examiner. But remember, for all the students, please convey, it will be very serious paper. It's not for the sake of that. Whatever paper or poster they are presenting, they should be ready with all the questions. Because if there are less paper and poster, the question answer will be more. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.